Hey y'all. Well, if we were on ASP, we would have just probably got home and unpacked all of our goodies and tried to get all of our laundry washed. And I was just thinking about how I missed it so much this year. And I thought, you know, maybe a message from Tex Evans and from a little story that we read every ASP might be helpful to you. And maybe you'll actually, instead of hearing it every year on the trip, hear it afterwards. And the process of us not being able to go, maybe can use it in a different way and hear Tex Evans' words and the intent that he wrote it. So I've got all my little pigtail day, my ASP quilt, got my Bob Gary, my overhauls on, and I've got my wonderful t-shirt from Adrian and Sydney. I've got my favorite ASP cross made by Steve Weaver. I got my favorite book, Life is Like That, from Tex Evans, the founder of ASP. He's a United Methodist minister that started this some several, many, many, many years ago. And he wanted to share some stories of the Appalachian Mountain when he was a minister in there. So I'm going to read you the story that's always dear to me and I always read on ASP, just maybe because I might need it too. I'm not kidding you. I need it too, and today. So I thought I'd share with that and hope that you enjoy it. It's called Why Brother Gentry Whistled. When I was a student in the university, I had a student charge, a beautiful little Methodist church in a quiet community. And I had the privilege of living in the parsonage while my sweet wife and I took care of that little bitty church. We had three delightful years there, and any other preacher will understand that no church is ever quite as magnificent and grand and remarkable as one's first church. Now, this church had very few people, but those it did have were indescribable in their kindness and friendliness and helpfulness to one another and to their neighbors and to this preacher and his wife. And one other thing in the church which was due for special mention and recognition was a teacher for our adult Sunday school class, a Baptist saint named T.T. Gentry. He was a retired school teacher from Oklahoma and was in love with life. I am sure that the children who had him as a teacher found themselves blessed in more ways than one can count. Brother Gentry loved the soil and the creatures of the forest, the birds and the bees and the rabbits and the squirrels, almost as much as he loved people. And one of his choice even was that he loved poetry. Now, all this I say just to indicate the kind of man he was. One day I was walking with another fellow up the street and he said to me, "Tex, did you ever go up to see Brother Gentry in the daytime?" When I assured him that I had, he said to me, "Well, did you ever notice that he has apple trees and beehives and a rose garden and a vegetable garden and a regular flower garden?" When I assured him that I had noticed that, he had another question. "Well, did you ever notice that no matter what he's doing, whether if he's in the rose garden or taking care of his bees or working with his apple trees, no matter what, he is always whistling?" Well, I allowed that I had noticed that Brother Gentry did whistle. Then my friend reminded me that he didn't even whistle a tune. He just very loudly whistled. He would just whistle in a sure, steady tone, going from one pitch to another, as just to give some to variety, I suppose, to the exercise. Then he had another question for me. "Now, do you know why he whistles?" When I admitted that I did not, as a matter of fact, know any reason for his whistling, he had a suggestion for me. "Well, the next time you are over there and he's whistling, you look over on the front porch and you will see why Brother Gentry whistles." Now, I could hardly wait. On Tuesday, I came home as early as I could from the university. I parked my car and told my wife that I had to go up and see Brother Gentry about something, and I did. And I went walking briskly down the little street towards his home. And before I got right up to the house, I could hear him in his rose garden whistling away in his slow, firm tone, changing the pitch from one to the other from this to that as he constantly whistled. When I walked up, Brother Gentry, he looked at me. And he paused and he raised his hand and said, "Come on over and I'll give you a rose." He had on some rather rough gloves. He had some little snippers in his hands and he was trimming some roses. I walked up close to Brother Gentry. I paid him a brief courtesy and asked him how he was getting along and quickly looked toward the front porch. There on the porch sat Mrs. Gentry. She was in a wheelchair and she was blind. Brother Gentry was whistling for Mrs. Gentry. He wanted her to know that he was there. He wanted her to know that she was not alone. He wanted her to know that he was mindful of her, that he would not leave her, that he was available, and that he would come to her. Now I went home from that meeting, having been enriched immeasurably. I had seen something entirely beautiful and lovely and true. And I said to myself, God is like that. He knows about us. He is concerned for us. He is aware of his children and he will not leave them. Our Father will not desert his children. Our Father will come to us. I will not try to make any long application of this beautiful truth. I will just comment that I am constantly astonished at the folk who are so caught up with complaining and whining and fear and doubt and worry. And they have been within walking distance of the Christian faith all their lives. They ought to be right in touch with immeasurable sources of love and light, with meaning and power and hope. In these brief words, I would just like to remind you that you are not alone. You are loved. Our Father knows. Our Father cares. Our Father will not go away or leave us. We will not be deserted. He will come to us. So, as we begin any new day, we might very well say, "Well, this may be a pretty rough day, but I can at least count on this. Our Father is whistling all the time." I hope this story blesses you and it reminds you that we are in the distance of grabbing hold of all of God's love for us and that he is there for us in the midst of everything. I hope that you continue to pray for our friends, our brothers and sisters in Christ in the Appalachian Mountains. Maybe think of those memories that you've had if you've gone before and think on those folks and just ask for God to surround them with his warmth, his love, his safety, and his health for them. And I wanted you also to think about you being a disciple of Christ and knowing that God surrounds you and to extend that, even though we're not in Appalachia, but extend that in your day that you are going to go through each day. Don't ever forget and always listen for God whistling for you all the time. Now, it wouldn't be appropriate if I just left it with goodbye. So I want to leave you with this. Don't ever forget all those guardian angels who have taught you everything about life, about love, about patience and kindness and truth, about abilities and skills that you have. Don't ever forget them and know that they are watching over you. Like our little ASP angels, and maybe a little Marilyn, I think. So I want to leave you and bless you with a little Marilyn and bless your day. I love you dearly. You have the best of days listening for God's whistle. Are you ready?